Good afternoon. Thousands of protesters from opposing groups have marched through Melbourne CBD. And as Mark Santomartino explains, groups chanted against the Victorian Premier and the pandemic bill while a counter-demonstration took aim at the far right.
For yet another week, thousands upon thousands of protesters that started on the steps of State Parliament are moving en masse through the city. They've gone right through Bourke Street Mall, where Christmas shoppers were, up Queen Street, and now we're about to turn onto Lonsdale.
Free Victoria!
A message with weight behind it that could only be appreciated from the sky. They piled into Flagstaff Gardens en masse, met by a band and no shortage of those looking to grab the mic. One man was dragged out by protest security, but police had little to do but babysit the mostly peaceful crowd. That included unvaccinated 12-year-old Kayla.
I got excluded. I was crying this morning because I couldn't go to my jiu-jitsu.
I'm here for my children. I'm worried about their future.
I just don't think that's right to give so much power to one person.
Somehow the crowd managed to avoid a separate, smaller band of protesters protesting them.
Anti-vaxxers, you can hide!
Undermining, democracy, and we're here to say, actually, being on the left, we need to be pro-health and we need to tackle these far ideas.
Gallows and guillotines were widely condemned this week, but threats continue against the crossbenchers, negotiating in good faith.
Even some of the harshest critics of the bill would say that it's not perfect, but it's an improvement on what we've got.
That bill is a lockdown bill, and it's a bill that's designed by Daniel Andrews to be used for further lockdowns.
And yet, according to the latest news poll, the Premier is more popular now than he was at Labor's landslide 2018 election win.
Don't believe no poll. This is your poll.
Over and over, they've chanted to sack Dan Andrews, to jail Dan Andrews. Their main issue is the vaccine mandate, as well as the pandemic legislation, which will return to Parliament on the 30th of November.
Cricket Australia has conceded Tim Paine should have been sacked as Test captain years ago over the sexting scandal. Charles Croucher joins us live now with the very latest on this. Charles, the chairman has spoken just moments ago.
He has, Alicia, and what he said effectively was that he's distanced himself from the decision that was made right after Tim Paine became captain of Australia, once Cricket Australia became aware that this sexting scandal would linger over the head of Tim Paine while he remained in the top job. The current administration say they would not have made the same decision. However, they were aware, as soon as the current chair and all those in high-ranking officials came into those roles, they were made aware through briefings that these allegations were put to Tim Paine. He was cleared by an integrity investigation in Tasmania, and they continued to allow him to stay in that role. They also said that while this is being consideration and the right move was made in Tim Paine stepping down as leader, they said it is right for him to still seek to wear the baggy green and attempt to keep his spot in the team if chosen as the wicketkeeper. That will be in the hands of selectors who are now moving to not only finalise the team for that first test, but also choose a captain. More on that in a moment, but now here is what Cricket Australia had to say today.
Is faced with the same circumstances and with the benefit of all the relevant information about this matter, Cricket Australia would not make the same decisions today.
As for who will lead the Australian team, Pat Cummins is the favourite, the 28-year-old from Penrith. He is a fast bowler, a rarity in world cricket to see a quick lead a team, particularly one as high profile as Australia. But the chairman of the Cricket Australia chief executive today said Steve Smith is under consideration amongst an entire group that may take on that top job. There's not long to go until the Ashes, and a decision will have to be made about who will toss the coin on that first day in Brisbane.
Yes, absolutely. All right, Charles Croucher, thank you. Well, doubts remain over whether world number one Novak Djokovic will compete at January's Australian Open. As Reid Butler explains, Tennis Australia has made it clear no unvaccinated players will be welcome.
It is remarkable to think that in January, fans will again pack Melbourne Park, the Australian Open able to operate at capacity. Big names are coming down for the tournament, including Naomi Osaka, Serena Williams and Rafael Nadal. But there is a question mark still hanging over the head of one tennis player, and that man is Novak Djokovic.
We would love to see Novak here. He knows he has to be vaccinated in order to play. He's won the Australian Open 9 times. I think he'd love to make it a double digit to win it 10 times.
If the defending champion was to win again at Melbourne Park, his Grand Slam tally would finally eclipse rivals Rafael Nadal and Roger Federer. But the Serbian is refusing to reveal his vaccination status, and if he doesn't, he'll be forced to bypass the tournament. More than 80% of the travelling player group have been fully vaccinated, and that's up from 50% when the no jab, no play policy was announced 6 weeks ago. Tennis Australia chief Craig Tiley confident that figure will get to 100%.
I don't expect there to be many, probably very, very few, if any, that wouldn't be fully vaccinated in order to come here.
This huge event is what Victoria's tourism economy has been waiting for. It's desperately in need of a cash injection.
Unbelievable news to have full crowds back, and we can't wait.
Capacity will be boosted by this new 5,000-seat show court area.
This will be the biggest show on earth for that 2 weeks in January, and I'm sure it will generate a huge amount of interest and excitement and a lot of inbound visitors to Australia throughout 2022.
Tickets for the Australian Open are on sale now.
18-year-old Kyle Rittenhouse has been found not guilty of killing 2 people and shooting another during protests in Kenosha last year. US correspondent Alison Petrowski reports.
Well, Kyle Rittenhouse sobbed and collapsed as the not guilty verdict was read out in court.
We, the jury, find the defendant, Kyle H. Rittenhouse, not guilty.
In August of 2020, violent protests took place after Kenosha police shot and seriously injured a 29-year-old black man, Jacob Blake. Rittenhouse, who was 17 at the time, showed up at these protests with a rifle. He shot and killed 2 men and wounded another. He took the stand this week and argued that it was in self-defence, and today the jury agreed. Acquitted on all counts, Rittenhouse is now a free man.
He has a huge sense of relief for what the jury did to him today. He wishes none of this would have ever happened. But as he said when he testified, he did not start this. And we're thankful in more ways than one that the jury finally got to hear the true story.
Rittenhouse cannot be retrialed in the state, as that would be double jeopardy. Families of the victims say that this ruling sets a dangerous precedent. President Joe Biden throwing his support behind the decision.
I stand by what the jury has concluded. The jury system works and we have to abide by it.
With so much tension leading up to this verdict, the National Guard is on standby with fears that protests could erupt on the streets of Kenosha.
Billionaire Clive Palmer has addressed the crowd at a freedom rally in Brisbane. COVID-19 has given the mining magnate the chance to rebuild the United Australia Party on an anti-lockdown platform. And experts say both sides of politics should be worried. Fiona Willen explains.
Clive Palmer has been working the crowd at a freedom rally in Brisbane today, and he'll be hoping this helps his United Australia Party score some votes at the federal election. It didn't go well at the 2019 election. It failed to pick up a single seat, despite an $80 million donation from Mr Palmer's company. However, things have changed since then. COVID-19 has given him the chance to rebuild and campaign on an anti-lockdown platform, zeroing in on pandemic politics.
And at the next federal election, there's going to be a big change in this country. We've got 80,000 members in our party, and we're coming at you, Scott Morrison and Elbo Albanese and anyone else, because Australia is going to be a free and independent country again.
Something else that's changed, the United Australia Party has a new leader, Liberal defector Craig Kelly. He's an outspoken MP who's gained a following during COVID-19 for his controversial views. Together, Mr Palmer and Mr Kelly have launched a two-pronged attack, and they have Mr Palmer's very deep pockets to fund it, already spending millions bankrolling advertisements targeting the major parties.
All the parties need to be worried about what Clive Palmer and his form of money politics can actually do to the next election.
The Liberals should be worried by him because he's taking votes off people who are unhappy with the government, but I know Labor doesn't underestimate him either.
Clive Palmer will soon be announcing candidates for his party. Nominations closed this week, and a spokesperson told Nine News around 2,000 people applied.
Up to 20,000 Queenslanders have descended on the Gold Coast for the week-long Schoolies party.
Here, it's a great opportunity for our businesses to make some money after what's been a difficult time for our tourism industries. Spend some money, stay safe and have a great time.
Extra police and paramedics have been brought in from around the state to monitor the celebrations.